course you knew that because you've been watching the show for 21 years. Now on YouTube, we're reaching an international audience who love anything fabulous and anything French or anything Belgian, like La Rouge Tomate. This is an extension of our Bonjour! Our Bastille Day show, where we met Pascaline Lepeltier and discovered Rouge Tomate. And now we're going to be shooting a whole show in here with Scott Siegel and his Broadway's rising stars of this year, who are very exciting, and David Kaufman, and some good summer books to read. But, you know, stay tuned. And now here we are inside Rouge Tomate, and I'm going to do something I haven't done in a while. I'm going to do a book review of this fabulous new biography. Oh my God, is it heavy. It's definitive. It's huge. It's everything you've ever wanted to know about the great British actress Dame Sybil Thorndike. And she was just one of the greatest actresses of the last century. And she was Shaw's St. Joan. I mean, she and her husband had a 60-year marriage, and it was the longest working partnership. He was an actor too, and a director. It's the longest married couple in British theater history, and she was so devoted to the theater. I've always wanted to know about her because she reminded me a bit of my grandmother, the grand style that she had, my British grandmother, and Sybil had that too. And Alfred Hitchcock's Stage Fright, which has like a paragraph in this huge book, she didn't consider film or the stage. She liked radio a little better. I mean, she considered film and TV less than the stage. Everything should be the stage. She was from the grand tradition of stage acting, and it's just wonderful. It's everybody's in this book. And to see George Bernard Shaw come in it as a friend, and somebody who was supporting her and wasn't somebody who was like chasing her around or anything like all the other famous actresses that he, famously Ellen Terry and Janet A. Church and a whole bunch, Mrs. Patrick Campbell. He just besieged actresses and wrote them millions and millions of letters, although he never had any kind of, they were romantic entanglements, but it never went further than that. He had a very sensible relationship with Dame Sybil when they did St. Joan. And her husband directed a lot of Shaw's plays. He liked Louis Casson, Sir Louis Casson at the end. Both of them lived into their 90s. I mean, it's a rollicking read. It's a page turner. I finished this whole book just for today, just to tell you, Dame Sybil Thorndike, a star of life, and she certainly was. She was a socialist, she was a pacifist, George Bernard Shaw's best friend, and she started Laurence Olivier's career. I mean, she did everything. And she lived, and her husband lived into their 90s. At one point in the book, they're going on a two-year tour of the Far East, performing all over the place in their 70s. I mean, obviously acting is healthy for you, or at least stage acting. And I just can't recommend this wonderful book highly enough. Dame Sybil Thorndike, A Star of Life. And now we're going to hear about another fabulous book with David Kaufman, the author of the new best-selling biography, now in paperback, of Doris Day. I know you've seen it before, but he's got more to tell you about Doris, so stay tuned. So David, your book is a bestseller. I'm so happy for you. And your shirt matches the cover.
That's true as well. In fact,
next time get a new shirt. But
it's
anyway,
incredible what
wore it
happened
last year.
I think I've mentioned before that I've now done 43 radio interviews about Doris Day in this book and 11 TV interviews. One of them was CBS Sunday Morning last summer.
Which was wonderful.
Which
that was a
made,
wonderful
it made
show.
The Kloff book a New York Times bestseller. And the incredible thing is just this July, they decided to re-air the segments.
And it was
and that
wonderful.
Made the paperback a bestseller.
You read it on that than you ever were on my show. I was like, why isn't it good this good? And this tourists all the time. But anyway, you were going to talk to Doris through the endless topic. We can't get enough of Doris Day. We can't. The public can't. And you were going to talk to her,
well,
weren't you?
Well, in fact,
you haven't spoken to her yet. She doesn't talk to people who write about her.
No. But I have been told by a person who's one of her handlers for the last 30 years that she thinks Doris is going to talk to me finally after all this time. However, I have to wait a little bit before calling because Doris was upset by the CVS segment because it brought so much attention on her again, which, you know, lots of calls from people from the past who she hadn't heard from, and it was too much for her. So that kind of upset her, but there's another friend.
She's the girl next door who wasn't living next door. She was a very complex person. And a personality, which you get
is.
To, and an artist,
and
still is, obviously.
But talking about the girl next door, there's a man named Ted Nash, who actually was a musician in Les Brown's band, the band that Doris sang for in the 40s. He remains very close with Doris. He and his wife moved to Carmel in the mid-80s to be near Doris.
Oh.
And I have spoken to him since the book has come out. And he's in touch with Doris. And there's a woman named Joni Huntington, who was going to work with Ted on his memoir.
How old is she now?
Doris is 87 and
oh
a half.
Oh my God.
87 and a half, last April.
And very 40. Healthy, evidently.
She's in very good shape, yeah.
As was Dame Sybil Thorndike, who I just reviewed this book. I actually read this whole book, and I read your whole book, and I want to keep talking about this fabulous book and its impact, well, how David and I met, which we never get to talk about, is you were writing the great biography of Charles Ludlam, which was how we met. David, the thing about, I mean, it's inevitable that you and Doris become friends because you became friends with everybody you wrote about in the Charles Ludlam book, which biographers never do. This
and
never
now
happens.
And I've become friends with a
Kate
number
Ballard
of Doris's friends.
Is a friend of yours now, and,
yes.
And Rex Reed, and all these lovely people.
And a lot of people who lived with Doris and worked for her at various points in her life. Are also friends, and I'm now befriending people.
Is this something
people.
You do deliberately? I mean, you
yes.
befriend everybody.
Well,
that's nice.
Well,
know.
It's also just in the course of getting to know their stories. I'm now
you're a nice
interviewing
person,
a lot of people
you're
who,
a very sweet guy,
who work
so.
With Mary Martin, who is the subject of my next book. So,
Mary, a scoop, Mary Martin? My mother thought she was Mary Martin, you know.
And I sometimes think I'm Peter Pan. So.
Well, maybe she thought she was Peter Pan. She thought she was Mary Martin as Peter Pan. I remember asking her, you know, when it was on television, it was my first encounter with Mary Martin, why is Peter Pan being played by a girl, Mommy? And she said,
that's
well,
the tradition, actually.
That's what she said.
It goes way back.
These two great ladies together here is that my friend Lucy Peacock from the Stratford Shakespeare Festival is her great niece. So that's how we, you know. Anyway, I think Elvis has just entered the building. We swing around, and guess who's here? It's Scott Siegel! Just in time. Let's give Scott a round of applause. On your wonderful, this is a celebration of Scott Siegel's spectacular summer at Town Hall.